There's a plan being put together now. When will we see it? I mean, when will the public be able to say, here's a marker, we're going to hold Secretary of Defense Mattis, the president, to this timeline, that ship, that shipyard?
You're going to see it quickly. I can't give you an exact date because we're still honing out some of the numbers. And one of the things we're doing, Hugh, which is really important to understand, is especially when it comes to the Navy, and I defer to Ms. Lord up at AT&L at OSD, but with the Navy, and she's in line with this, we are really approaching industry now and saying we have to work in terms of partnership. And what I mean by partnership is shared risk, shared rewards. We have to be teammates in this. That doesn't mean that we're not going to have competitive situation buying fiduciarily appropriately the best money can buy for our taxpayers, but we can't have a completely adversarial the best money can buy from the absolute cheapest, drawn out, painful contract process. We need ideas now. We need expedition now. We need to have industry on our side with us, working side by side for solutions at the right price.
Yesterday, Secretary of Defense Mattis was at the DMZ in Korea, just as a third carrier, I believe it's the Nimitz, entered the Western Pacific for the first time in 4 or 5 decades. Are we prepared if it comes to blows? Do you think those carriers are defended? And can the F-18s that are on them penetrate North Korean airspace without getting shot down?
The carrier, I am safe to say the carrier is a well-protected asset. Yes, you.
And what about the F-18s in the North Korean airspace?
They will have their match, and I think we have a superior outcome there.
All right. Now, talk to me about building two carriers at the same time. It's one of the new initiatives that you've come out with, which makes a lot of sense to a civilian like me, but is it hard to sell to the Congress?
It's very interesting. This is going on right now, and this is a perfect example of leaning in. The four committees that would entertain any sort of action like this, and this is a bold action, but we have been working with industry with a number that makes it worthwhile for us to put this proposition forward. And there's a lot of heavy lifting with this proposition. But in initial conversations with the committees, everyone is leaning in to say, how can we do it versus we can't do it.
And can you reclaim ships from the so-called ghost fleet?
We can. Here's what we're doing on the ghost fleet, specifically the Perry class is one that we're looking at. One, we're not going to do a lot of them. There might be 10 Perry class that are even in the zone to be retrofitted. But what we're looking at now in this whole buildup of what the fleet's going to look like is we're starting to look at matching the asset off against the threat. So we have drug interdiction down in the Caribbean basin on the Pacific side of Latin America. Can we put a refitted the Perry class frigate down there? I think we can match threat with that.
Makes a lot of sense to me. Last question. You're a Marine. 182,000 Marines. That's down significantly from where it was at the height of the invasion of Iraq. Does the Marine Corps need more Marines in it?
I think if they need, in speaking to the Commandant, the need might be there, but it's incremental to where we are now. We're actually up at 189. The question is, do you go up to 190, 200? It's incrementally not a huge number. The Marine Corps is in pretty good shape. What we have to really get our hands around is debt to dwell. We have to get that so we know.
Expand, I don't get that.
I'm sorry, deployment to dwell time.
Okay.
So how much time do we have home to reach? Charged, be with family, quality of life versus deploying yet again.
And then the spinoff of that is, how about sailors? At a 279 ship fleet going to 350, I'm holding you to this promise, that's a lot more sailors. Do you have a recruitment plan? Do you have a budget plan? And do we have reform of pension and pay so that we'll be able to afford it long term?
And you hit a very interesting nail right the head, Hugh. My three priorities: people, capabilities, and process. People are the most important thing that we have. Otherwise, it's just a piece of aluminum in the air or metal floating on the water or under the water. They are also our most expensive asset. They're our most valuable asset and our most expensive asset, and we have to think this thing through. Yes, we have a plan, because we can't grow to 355 ships and just keep the Navy the same size it is. We're going to have to man and staff.
Columbia class, I'm sneaking one in because I got the time. Columbia class to replace the Ohio class. I asked every presidential candidate about this. Are they on time? Will they be there? Or are you going to have to extend the life of the Ohio class boomer submarine that is the key part of our nuclear deterrent?
The nuclear triad, as you know, the submarine is the stealthiest of the whole leg of the triad. And it's, I think, one of the most important, not just wearing the Navy hat, but looking at the actual nuclear triad itself. Columbia class, I will be very, very candid and open. It's a public record. It's critical we keep that on time, on schedule. The way we have all our assets rolling off, we're going to look at the ability to actually schlep them, i.e. service life extension, for every single asset and platform we have. But Columbia class, to keep it unfunded, on schedule, is critical.
How often do you get updated on that, Mr. Secretary?
That's twice a week.
Is it really?
Oh, yes. We have eyes on.
Thank you for coming in. I hope you come back. Maybe we'll do a six-month checkup on that 350-ship plan.
I welcome it, Hugh. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Richard Spencer, the Secretary.